Hi everyone, welcome to our shed where Alan and I have taught and lectured for most of lockdown. So I'm going to talk about Blessed Are the Peacemakers. And I was reflecting that the last time I did the talk was actually in December, and I spoke about life and light and love. And 3 days after that, my brother died. And at his funeral, I had to do the Bible reading, and I spent a long, long time choosing what passage to read. And then it came to me, I had to choose the Beatitudes because they just spoke to me so much about my brother. Now, he was a very quiet and very shy man, and he did struggle a lot with some areas of his life. And in particular, he always felt that he wasn't good enough. He wasn't as good as other people, and especially as good as his brothers and sisters. And he used to say that he couldn't do any of the things that we could do. And that was quite hard because it wasn't the case. But anyway, in the kingdom of God, it's not about what we can do. It's about what we can be. And my brother was really humble, and he had a hunger and thirst for justice, and above all, he was a peacemaker. So I'm going to divide this talk into two parts, and I'm going to say something first about the Beatitudes in general, and then I'll go on to talk about Blessed Are the Peacemakers. So I think most of you know that I'm an RE teacher, and as part of that I teach ethics, which is the study of how to live a good or moral life. Now, most of the ethical theories that I teach about focus on actions, what we should do or what we shouldn't do. But there's one theory I teach about which is very, very different. It's called virtue ethics. And it's associated most with the philosopher Aristotle. Now, Aristotle lived a long, long time before Jesus. Well, I'm only going to tell you the briefest of things about virtue theory because this is a Sunday morning talk, not a lesson. And I'm on holiday now, so if you want to know more about Aristotle, you'll have to ask another time. But virtue theory is not at all about what actions we should avoid or what rules we should follow. It's actually about developing your character. Aristotle argued that as human beings, we have a special function which animals don't have, and it's called reason. And as part of this, he said we have something called practical wisdom, which means that with practice we can cultivate virtues such as courage and patience and so on, which will help us to live in a good way, and then we'll just know how to act in different situations. So in this way of looking at things, the most important thing is not actually what you do, but what you are, because your actions spring from your character. And Aristotle argued that this way of living enables us to attain our final purpose or function, which he called eudaimonia. And we generally translate that as human flourishing. Now, to go back to my brother, I know he didn't really see himself as someone who was flourishing at being a human being. And part of the reason for that is because this world has all kinds of ways of deceiving us, that we haven't really made it unless we have a certain kind of job or a house or a certain relationship or family of our own or certain possessions. But actually, David did have many of the virtues that Aristotle prized. He was courageous, He was witty. He was generous. And also patient. And although he wasn't somebody who ever went to church or ever spoke about whether he had any faith in God, I'd say that he did score pretty well on many of the virtues that the Apostle Paul calls the fruits of the Spirit in Galatians chapter 5. And of that list of qualities, David was really good at love, patience, kindness, goodness and gentleness. Now, when I look at the Beatitudes, and actually the rest of the Sermon on the Mount as well, it looks to me that Jesus is saying something similar. Because what he's doing is he's describing the characteristics of people who seek after their true purpose to reflect the character of God. So we've learned in the past few weeks about those people who hunger and thirst for righteousness, the pure in heart, and so on. So it's not really about actions, it's about attitudes. It's about a way of being. Now, I know this isn't what the word means. Beatitude means blessed or happy or fortunate. But I think it's actually very appropriate to say that you could call them Beatitudes, attitudes to being. So if you've missed any of the previous weeks, listen to them again, because every single one of them was fab. And I actually thought, well, there's nothing left to say when we come to today's topic, blessed are the peacemakers. So I thought, well, we'll watch that famous clip instead, because you've all been waiting for it. So here goes. Here's that film.
How blessed are the sorrowful. They shall find consolation. How blessed are those of gentle spirit. They shall have the earth for their possession. How blessed are those who hunger and thirst to see right prevail. They shall be satisfied.
Speak up!
Quiet, Mom.
Well, I can't hear a thing. Let's go to stoning.
You can go to a stoning any time.
Oh, come on, Brian.
Will you be quiet?
Don't pick your nose.
I wasn't picking my nose, I was scratching.
You were picking it while he was talking to that lady.
I wasn't.
Leave it alone. Give it a rest.
Do you mind? I can't hear a word he's saying.
Don't you do you mind me? I was talking to my husband.
Well, go and talk to him somewhere else. I can't hear a bloody thing.
Don't you swear at my wife.
I was only asking her to shut up so he can hear what he's saying, big nose.
Don't you call my husband big nose.
Well, he has got a big nose.
Could you be quiet, please?
What was that? I don't know. I was too busy talking to big nose.
I think it was blessed are the cheesemakers.
What's so special about the cheesemakers?
Well, obviously, it's not meant to be taken literally. It refers to any manufacturers of dairy products.
See, if you haven't been going on, we'd have heard that, big nose.
Hey, say that once more, I'll smash your face in.
Better keep listening. Might be a bit about blessed are the big noses.
Oh, lay off him.
Oh, you're not so bad yourself, conk face. Where are you two from? Nose
Don't
City?
Don't pick your nose.
I wasn't going to pick my nose. I'm going to thump him.
You hear that? Blessed are the Greek. The Greek. Well, apparently, he's going to inherit the earth.
Did anyone catch his name?
You're not going to thump anybody.
I'll thump him if he calls me Big Nose again.
Oh, shut up, Big Nose.
Oh, what? I warned you. I really will slug you so
hard. Oh, it's the meek. Blessed are the meek. Oh, that's nice, isn't it? I'm glad they're getting something because they have a hell of a time.
Okay, so that was from the film The Life of Brian by Monty Python people. And I know when the film came out, there was a lot of unrest and people thought it must be making a mockery of Jesus. But to be honest, the film isn't really about Jesus. It's about Brian. But actually, there's a very useful film really there, because it helps us to understand quite a lot about the context of Jesus' ministry. And when you watch that clip, you get to see an awful lot of stuff. I use this clip in my lessons quite a lot and other parts of the film as well to explain something about the context of Jesus' ministry. And I think it's really interesting there that we saw the Roman soldiers, because of course Jesus lived in an occupied country. He was from a race of people who'd been subject to a foreign power. And those soldiers are standing there. Now, their job was to preserve what's called the Pax Romanica, the peace of the Roman Empire. And I just think it's quite funny that they're standing by while the crowd has a punch-up. And actually, you might not have seen the punch-up. We might have cut the clip off before that. But despite the funny bits about the cheesemaker speech, I actually think that the writers of the film might have been kind of provoking us to think quite a lot about what it means to be a peacemaker. So, what is a peacemaker? And for that matter, what is peace? Perhaps we need to be like the man in the crowd who wondered what Jesus meant. Maybe how we interpret peace isn't the same understanding that Jesus was conveying in that context. So Jesus spoke Aramaic, which is a form of Hebrew, and he was Jewish. So first of all, we need to consider what word he might have used when he preached this message, when he spoke the Beatitudes. And then we have to be aware as well that Matthew's gospel was written in Greek. So Jesus' words would have been translated from Aramaic to Greek before we get to the English words that we're thinking about in the translations of the Bible that most of us read. So perhaps we think of peace, first of all, as just the opposite of war, like the end of fighting. But if you think about it a bit more, when the Second World War ended, it didn't really lead to lasting peace, because what came out of it was the Cold War. So what replaced the actual fighting was division and hostility between two competing ideologies. And that kind of division and distrust and hostility and suspicion of the other is still a cause of a lack of peace in so many situations today. If we switch on the news or read a newspaper, we don't have to be watching or reading for long before we see that even where there isn't actually armed combat, there is some of that in the world, in all sorts of parts of the world, there are still also very, very many situations where things are just not right, just not good. And we've been praying about a lot of these things for some time. And we'll pray about them today probably too. Now, in Hebrew, which is the language of the Old Testament, and that's the scriptures that Jesus used, the word that's translated as peace is actually the word shalom. And you might have heard this word being used as a greeting between Jewish people. And if not that, then maybe you've heard the word salam, which is the Arabic equivalent. And that's used as a greeting between Muslim people. And in both cases, you could say that wishing somebody that greeting is to wish them peace. But what you're saying to that person is a lot more than, oh, I hope you don't get into a fight. You see, shalom and salam convey a picture of wholeness or completeness. Now, I know Neil is always warning us about Wikipedia, and I do the same to my students as well, but I'm openly and brazenly today going to use a quote from Wikipedia, because I've triple checked it against all sorts of biblical sources and Hebrew commentaries on the Hebrew and so on, and I'm happy that this statement from Wikipedia is fairly useful and accurate. So Wikipedia says this: in the Bible, shalom means universal flourishing, wholeness, and delight, a rich state of affairs in which natural needs are satisfied and natural gifts fruitfully employed. A state of affairs that inspires joyful wonder as the Creator and Saviour opens doors and welcomes the creatures in whom he delights. Now, when I was reading that, did you notice that phrase, universal flourishing? Well, that sounds to me very similar to Aristotle's idea of eudaimonia. But neither individual human beings, nor society, nor the whole planet, the environment itself, can flourish when people are abused or exploited by others, when there isn't a fair sharing of resources, and when people lack what they need. The Jesus that we meet in the Gospels constantly spoke against and acted in situations where shalom was missing. He prevented the stoning of a woman caught in adultery, pointing out that none of her accusers were actually perfect themselves. He socialised and shared meals with a bunch of so-called undesirables who were left out of polite society. He healed a Roman soldier's servant and a woman afflicted with a gynecological problem, which meant that people had shunned her for 12 years. He created and told amazing stories of forgiveness and challenge. Stories like the prodigal son and the good Samaritan. And in John's Gospel, Jesus says that he has come so that we might have life in all its fullness. And I read that as Jesus saying that he has come to bring shalom. Now, if you look at our Facebook name, we share one Facebook account across our household, and we only use it for church. You can see that we call ourselves Beth Shalom. And the picture is actually, it's a breadboard I painted with the words Beth Shalom and a dove and an olive branch. And we used to have it hung up outside our house, but we took it down. Partly because it got I hadn't sealed it very well, and so it started to split in the rain. But also because maybe we can't live up to that at the moment. Maybe our house is not a Beth Shalom, a house of peace, because that's what it means. To be honest, I don't think anybody's house is a house of peace all the time, especially Shalom peace. I like to think it's an aspiration rather than an actual fact at the moment. It's what we're aiming towards. So it's an ongoing thing, really. And Aristotle said that about the virtues. He said, one swallow doesn't make a summer. You don't express a virtue once and then that's it. It's done. You have to keep working at it. So we are trying. But there are two members of our household at the moment who need to work on Beth Shalom. So I better tell you about them. You probably, those of you who know as well, wondering which two it is. Well, recently we acquired a kitten. And our five-year-old cat is really struggling at the moment to accept her. They're at the spitting and hitting stage. Not hitting, hissing stage at the moment. And we want them to stop that, but we want them more than that. We want more than just that they don't hiss or fight. We actually want them to live peaceably together as full members of the same household. And after 2 weeks, there's been some progress, but it is going to be a bit of a slow process. Because how can we expect them to live peaceably together while they have distrust and suspicion? So there's some work we need to do there. We need to make sure that each of them has what they need, not just food and shelter and clean litter trays and somewhere cozy and comfortable to sleep and so on. But we also need to show them both that they are loved. And in time, when they don't see each other as having to compete for those things, for food, for love and so on, when they understand that there's enough love for both of them, then we hope that they will be reconciled. Which brings me to the Greek word, the word that Matthew uses when he writes about the peacemakers. The word is erenopoios, and the Greek word for peace itself is erene. And funnily enough, Erin, our daughter, is named after that word, peace. And so that's the first bit. And the other part, the poios bit, is it's an active thing. It's conveying a sort of doing or making kind of idea. The whole word could be translated as someone who actively seeks the peace of God. So it implies quite a lot of things. It implies bringing about shalom, bringing about restored relationships, and even the word reconciliation. Because although this beatitude is the only place in the New Testament where the word is used as a noun, the same word or form of it is used as a verb in other places, and in particular in Colossians 1 verse 20, which talks about Jesus reconciling all things to himself through the cross. So there's a connection between shalom, erene, peace, and salvation or liberation. Now, I found this quote in a blog post by someone, and I thought they said it better than I could, so I'm going to read it. Shalom is one of the key words and images for salvation in the Bible. The Hebrew word refers most commonly to a person being uninjured and safe, whole and sound. In the New Testament, shalom is revealed as the reconciliation of all things to God through the work of Christ. God was pleased through Christ to reconcile to himself all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through Christ's blood shed on the cross. Shalom experienced is multidimensional. Complete well-being, physical, psychological, social, and spiritual. It flows from all of one's relationships being put right with God, within oneself, and with others. So, naturally, I looked up Colossians 1 verse 20 in a couple of versions. I looked it up in the Greek first, just dragging from my memory the Greek I learned many years ago. And yes, I can see that word, erenopoios. But what I really wanted to do was to see what the Message translation had to say about it. And I just love this. So here is 1 Colossians 1 verse 20 in the Message. Not only that, but all the broken and dislocated pieces of the universe, people and things, animals and atoms, get properly fixed and fit together in vibrant harmonies, all because of his death, his blood that poured down from the cross. I think that's a really beautiful translation of the ideas. And did you notice the mention of psychological in that description of shalom that I quoted? I guess we might equate it with peace of mind. Now, Jerome, who was one of the early church fathers, he also talks about this idea. He talks about making peace in our own hearts as well as between people. So this is what he wrote. The peacemakers are pronounced blessed. Namely, they who make peace first within their own hearts, then between brethren at variance. For what avails it to make peace between others while in your own heart are wars of rebellious vices? It might be that some of us actually struggle having peace within ourselves, like my brother did, like I do sometimes, maybe some of you. Maybe we can't forgive ourselves for something we've done or not done. Maybe we don't feel good enough. Maybe we think we don't do enough good stuff. Well, if that is us for now, let's not worry. Because I started off by saying that goodness is more about being than doing. Maybe all you can do at the moment, or all I can do at the moment, is to manage to seek God's peace. That is being a peacemaker. It's an active thing. And in John chapter 14, Jesus says that the peace he gives us is not at all like the peace that the world would give us. Jesus came to reconcile all things so that we might have life in all its fullness. So we can be reconciled to God, not because of what we do, but because of what Jesus has done. It's what we are, not what we do. And as with each of the Beatitudes, Jesus not only tells us who is blessed, but also what the outcome is of practicing each of the virtues he describes. And in this case, we are told that the outcome is that we will be called the children of God. Now, in life, children do seem to reflect something of their parents, often in looks. I'm sure Caitlin hates it when everyone says she looks just like me. So just as children reflect something of the likeness of their parents, so in being peacemakers, we will be reflecting the character of our heavenly parent, God. Now, I'm often told how much like my mum I am, not just in looks, but also in character. How much more encouraging is it to know that every time we are able, through our attitudes and the actions that stem from them, to bring shalom, when we do those things, God is smiling upon us and saying, "You are one of my beloved children. With you, I am well pleased." Amen.